Hey, everybody. Good morning. I'm Doug Benson. I'm going to moderate this thing because I think straws were drawn and I wasn't there when it happened. And I'm very happy to be, this is my third time participating in the comedy panel in as many years here at the festival. Thank you for getting up early and being excited about it. Who's excited? Gentleman who didn't clap and yawned at the same time sent a lot of signals about how he feels. We've got a bunch of people that are involved in various projects that films that, well, one guy's not involved in any films, but pick up your microphone. What's wrong with you? Are you a professional comedian? The rest of them, I don't mind they don't pick up their microphones yet. But we'll start down on the opposite end, and we'll just start off by each person. That'd be you, Bob. Each person introducing themselves and telling us about what brings them to Traverse City this year.
I thought you were doing that, Doug.
A bus or a plane? Me sitting here reading off of this piece of paper that was just handed to me is not really the best way to go, I don't think.
I don't agree.
All right, here we go. Bob Byington is the writer and director of Seven Chinese Brothers, an award-winning film that has no Chinese people in it whatsoever. Who wrote this? Is there anybody Chinese in Seven Chinese Brothers?
I heard you saying this in one of your podcasts, that there are no Chinese people in my movie.
Is it true?
Yes.
You may remember his multiple appearances here at Traverse City Film Festival over the years. My favorite was Somebody Up There Likes Me. Yeah, there you go. One nice little golf applause. Tiger Woods just sank a putt. This is your fourth. How many times have you been to the Traverse City Film Festival?
Yeah, four.
Use your microphone voice, Bob.
Four. Let's keep it moving, right?
No, we've got 90 minutes, so I really like when people actually have sentences that they speak instead of one word.
The best movie we showed at Traverse City is the movie that we showed in 2009, Registered Sex Offender. Who saw that? These two ladies saw Registered Sex Offender?
Yeah, front row, probably.
Yeah. Check it out.
Okay. Who's next?
Douglas. I thought you were going to do it.
Hey, Douglas. You really want me to read this thing? He's the director, writer, producer of the documentary Drunk, Stone, Brilliant, Dead, The Story of the National Lampoon. Has that played yet?
Not here. But is today Saturday? It plays tonight. 9 o'clock.
9 o'clock, which venue?
Milliken.
Why don't we have the audience moderate? Let's have the audience moderate and be the guests. The rest of us can go back to bed. The film is, you directed this movie, but you have been in the business of comedy for quite a while. Your first job was a production assistant on When Harry Met Sally. Oh. It's obviously up there on the screen what a great job you did as a production assistant. Like when they were like, I'll have what she's having, you're probably the one that had to bring it in.
Just about. Because my name ends in a T. I'm like the name at the end right before we didn't kill any dogs in the making of this movie.
That's a National Lampoon joke, right?
You caught that?
Yeah.
Tied in? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Well, the movie, the National Lampoon movie, just tell us a little bit about it. Like, why should people carve out that spot tonight to see this thing?
I mean, I want to go see very semi-serious about the New Yorker, so...
I think you could probably do that, right?
Are you either an Animal House person or a Vacation person? Who's Animal House?
Oh, there's people... It's like Elvis and the Beatles. You have to pick one.
Which would be the Stones.
Interesting. I like them both, but I guess if I had to choose, I'm more of an Animal House person. Because they probably won't make a dog remake of that. I'm only saying that the new Vacation is bad because it's got 23% on Rotten Tomatoes.
And it's not National Lampoon's Vacation.
Yeah, what's that about?
They didn't want to pay to put that on there, I'm sure. But it's different.
So how much of the history of the great National Lampoon is covered in your film?
We go from the beginning, and then we end around 1988, which is when the magazine stopped. So we don't go into movies like Master Debaters, which is an actual National Lampoon movie, National Lampoon's Master Debaters.
So you start with basically the history of the magazine and then get into how they branched off into a couple of the greatest comedies ever made. And then
the movie in some ways is typical Hollywood. So it's like they start out, they go to New York, they find success, then they drink too much, do too many drugs, and then it all goes downhill from there.
Really? And what is National Lampoon?
Sort of like last night. Of the panelists.
Is it still a thing, the magazine? Is there an online component or something now?
They're going to relaunch. There's some nice guys that took it over. They're going to relaunch the website, and they're starting to do some things. So it's trying to come back. But the new Vacation is not part of that comeback.
Yeah, apparently. It's unconnected, but they're probably thrilled that it's didn't turn out very well, at least according to the nation's critics. Although I must say that the new Mission Impossible, I snuck off and saw that last night, Rogue Nation, and it's got 90-some percent on Rotten Tomatoes, and now I'm convinced that somebody was paid off because it's terrible. Spoiler. I'm a big fan of the last one, Ghost Protocol, so this one was a huge disappointment to me. But that's not what we're here to talk about. Let's meet our next panelists. We've got two Bobs on the panel, and this we're going to call him Bob 1. Bob Mankoff is the subject of the documentary Very Semi-Serious. He's been the cartoon editor of The New Yorker since 1997. Yeah. In 77, he sold his first cartoon to The New Yorker. So are you happy to be the subject of this film?
I'm really happy about the film, and I'm interested in the National Lampoon film also, because I sold some of my very first cartoons to the National Lampoon when Ted Mann was the cartoon editor there. And it was very different than selling him to the New Yorker.
Yeah, you cleaned up your act for the New Yorker, apparently.
What's that?
You cleaned up your act a little bit.
No, they were the exact same cartoons.
Really?
We got 90 minutes, and so, you know, afterwards I'm selling this book.
Oh.
So I thought I'd read from it. No. For a while.
I'd like to read you some cartoons.
It's a book. And look, if you buy the book, I'll draw a little cartoon in it for you. And if that makes the book more valuable over time, I'd like it back. So the film is by I have nothing to do with the film except I'm not really the subject, although I'm sort of the pivot to the new cartoonists, the generations of cartoonists coming into the magazine. And when I took over in 1997, I had to look for a new generation of cartoonists. Most magazines, for example, by that time, like the National Lampoon, had disappeared. And so I submitted like 1,000 cartoons to the New Yorker before I was accepted between 1973 and 77. And my initial approach was, yeah, these kids got to do the same thing. They got to just get rejected, rejected, rejected. But I realized that wasn't going to happen. So I had to try to mentor a whole new generation. And the film is primarily about an older generation that's still there and new people who are coming in to do it. None of whom are Chinese, you know, but we're working on that.
Fair enough. Do you know when the next, is it going to play again, the film, here at the festival?
Yeah, this is good, you guys.
9 o'clock tonight.
Yeah, 9 o'clock tonight, and it's all going to be also be on Sunday, and then there's a Q&A afterwards where like, I'll tell you why you didn't win the New Yorker caption contest, or whatever else you want to know.
Is that something that happens a lot? People confront you about that?
Absolutely. We get about every week there's the back page, there's this sort of weird incongruous picture. We get 5,000 to 10,000 entries every week. And
between just 5,000 to 10,000 entries?
Yeah, well, 5,000 to 1,000,000 entries. Now, on the high end, it's 10,000, but on the average, if it's a sort of easy contest, maybe it's 10,000. If it's harder for people to figure out some joke for it, it would be easy for professional comedians like you, of course.
I don't know. Captions are hard. Like, yeah, that's like, it's like onion headlines. They're very difficult to write. When you get it right, it's brilliant. You know?
So people often say, how come I didn't win it? And although you get 5,000 captions, you don't get 5,000 different captions. You get huge clusters. So that's why you didn't win it. Some caption was better than yours. Although one guy from Chicago, who's an attorney, Larry Wood, has won it 6 times, and it's all done anonymously, so it's sort of a special talent.
And do people, like, get into it with you? Like, do they run it by you with their caption just to double check and make sure that they should have won?
Sure. But
what do you say to them? Next time, try something funny? Like, how do you let them down gently?
How do I let them down?
Or do you?
I go through the... I said, well, look, you didn't win because we just pick them out of a hat. And yours wasn't in the hat. actually, it's a ridiculous process by which we do it, in which the 5,000 come in. I have an assistant. He's usually from the Harvard Lampoon or, you know, some comedy background. We destroy his brain over a period of time by having him look at all the captions. He breaks them down into like 10 or 11 categories. I then take those. I use SurveyMonkey to send them out to the cartoon editors of The New Yorker. They come back with their ratings. I ignore them and pick the one I want. But it's sort of, so at least when you tell people this, they say, well, at least you're trying. You know what I mean? But there's actually no way to look at 5,000.
Yeah, you can't. You just can't do it.
You can't do it. But yeah. We do it. We do it.
You do your version of it.
We do it the best we can,
yeah.
Which is lousy.
It's kind of amazing that one guy won 6 times under those circumstances.
He's actually great at it. I mean, it's
so
like
you see his name on the submission, and then you know.
No, you don't. I mean, it's all done anonymously. So, Roger Ebert entered 107 times, and then finally won, and it was a big deal for him. But it's all done anonymously. So, you know, we try to be fair. We try to be the New Yorker.
If I were you, and I'm not, so you're lucky. I would get all of Roger Ebert's captions. And at each one of those pictures and publish it. Like, here's all the ones that failed, and then the book ends with the one where he finally got one through that, because I'm sure some of them were kind of funny, they just didn't win.
Instead of doing that, I wrote this book.
But I'm saying for your next one. You gotta, you know, you could do another book after this, success of this one. Everyone here is going to get a copy
if this panel goes on long enough, this could be the book.
Oh, sorry.
If you're going to speak, Geoff, please use your microphone. Thank you very much.
I didn't know that they were anonymous. I've won like 25 times. Like, it's getting boring now.
Yeah,
like,
it is boring after a while. Yeah, yeah.
Where's my jacket, like things like that, and then it's in there, and I'm like,
well, we give you a print when you win.
Many prints.
Yeah, I'm gonna enter now. I'm gonna go for it.
Yeah, go ahead.
I'm excited. I there's no way my sensibility would win, but I'll try. I'll give it a shot. And thank you for being here.
Well, it's a pleasure. Thank you.
Next up, we got a package deal. Bowman, is it pronounced Bowman?
Yes.
I know how to pronounce Modine because you must be related to the great Matthew Modine.
On IMDb, I am, yeah.
But what about in real life?
Yeah, that too.
Yeah. And you're sitting next to Adam Rakoff.
That's right.
And he's a frequent collaborator and producing partner with actor, producer, director Matthew Modine. So tell us what you guys are up to here at the festival.
Okay. Well, Bowman and I have a short film called Merry Xmas, starring Dick Van Dyke, Valerie Harper, Glenn Headley, and Matthew Modine. It's playing before my other film, The Brainwashing of My Dad, which is hilarious. So, but yeah, it's a short comedy, and you know, Bowman directed it, so I think he can talk about directing the legendary Dick Van Dyke.
I think it's interesting because my movie, half of it takes place in Hong Kong, but there are also no Chinese people in it. So I'm actually starting to wonder if
there's a Chinese voice.
There is a Chinese voice. So I got you. Yeah, we got that. Yeah, no, but we have a really amazing cast, and it's about 8 minutes long, so there's no time for it to lag, really. And, you know, you don't have to worry about the third act stretch or anything. So, yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty
Was there
much
a question?
Just a joke.
Yeah, it's a joke. It's an old joke that we just cheated and turned into a script.
Well, that's the thing about a lot of short films, especially comedy ones, is it sort of kind of tends to hinge on some sort of punchline at the end. So it's good that you have one, you know, because a lot of times when short films are over, I'm just kind of like, what? Well, I guess I'm glad it wasn't 90 minutes of that.
That's what we were going for. Don't make a 90-minute movie.
Sure, but then, so when's the brainwashing? What's it called again?
Yeah, The Brainwashing of My Dad. They play together, so if you...
When's the next one?
It's today at noon, right after this, but not here. It's at the... what's the...
OTP?
Yeah. That's the one.
Do they tell the filmmakers when and where their films are playing when they arrive here, or they just leave you in the dark?
Well, they just usher us around and...
Oh, that's true. They're so helpful at getting you everywhere when you need to be places that I guess you don't need to know. It's kind of like GPS. Nobody needs to know where anything is anymore. You just plug it, like the taxi driver just plugs it into his GPS because he doesn't know. And has the film already played once?
It played once on Wednesday.
And how was it received? People loved it?
People seem to really enjoy it. It's an interesting pairing. This they couldn't be farther apart. These two films. So one is it gives you a nice chuckle, and then you get into a much more serious topic about the brainwashing of people in this country from right-wing media. So
is it? But there's some humor to it.
Yeah, there are some funny moments.
Because I'd have to ask you to leave this panel if you brought a completely serious documentary to the.
There's definitely humor, and I mean, for those who have seen it, there were some good laughs in it.
Well, it's funny. You've got it.
Yeah. As a documentarian, were you inspired by Mr. Michael Moore?
Of course. I mean, I'm the producer.
You have to say that here.
The director definitely was. She's not here. I don't know if she's here. Jen Senko. It's a story about her father. So. Yeah, she is on camera, much like Michael Moore, kind of discovering, going on this journey to unravel what happened to her father and whether or not it's happened to other people. So it's,
I noticed that when she was up here on a panel, you were sitting right here supporting her.
I was. I don't know where she is. The door doesn't swing both ways.
She's having a nice breakfast or still asleep or something.
Or seeing a movie, you know.
Yeah, the 9 a.m. movies, I've been up for that every day. So today was kind of a break that we didn't have to start till 9:30. Eric Weinrib is here, everybody, director of Roseanne for President, !
Hello.
I love any title that has an exclamation point in it. And what's the next time is it playing again?
It is not playing again here at this festival.
But people did see it and enjoyed it. Front row ladies, they see everything. Especially if a child molester is involved. Wait, what was... And I don't know what kind of molester it was, to be honest. And what was your... Spending all that time documenting Roseanne Barr's run for president, like, what did you take away from, like, what did you learn about comedy from her, if anything?
It's so intimidating to be up here with comedians. I just made a movie about a comedian, so I'm just guilty by association. But I think that good comedy is layered and has purpose.
What? I do comedy, and I don't understand what
hilarious.
You're talking about.
Honestly, that was one of my favorite things about the documentary, amongst lots of things to enjoy. But I like just seeing the well-chosen clips from the Roseanne TV show, because it's easy to forget how groundbreaking and smart and how humanistic her show and her comedy was. Like, it was brilliant. And it was nice to see that, like, seeing scenes from the show in the movie, and then the whole audience laughing was really, it felt good. And it, last year, during the Q&A part, which we will get to today, so if you have any questions for anybody, get them ready in your heads, and leave out the part where you talk for a long time before getting to the question. And...
Yeah, right?
Are there any Chinese people here today? Is anyone not white?
Half.
What happened?
I don't know. Are we using Chinese people as like bait and switch for all these movies and panels? Like everyone's like, there's probably a Chinese person in this, and then nope. Still no Chinese.
Why are you here, Geoff?
Trying to find Chinese people, man. I was told this was a film festival about movies about Chinese people. And everyone I go to is just a huge disappointment. No, the movies are entertaining, but come on. Where's the Chinese people at? There's like a billion of them. You should have five on accident.
I don't think there are any Chinese people at Traverse City. I noticed the traffic moves pretty smoothly. But
I think there is one Chinese person in Roseanne for president. At least one.
Oh, that's good.
Are you sure it's not just a clip of Roseanne's last special in the kimono?
That's a tight reference. Geoff...
About a loose robe.
Geoff Tate is my friend who is making his third appearance at festivals in Traverse City. He was at the Comedy Festival in February.
Yep.
And, yeah.
Thank
Best you. Time of year to visit this city. Anybody who tells you that the summer is nicer is full of lies.
Yeah.
This last winter was, as everybody that I ran into told me, probably one of the coldest on record. And we were here and still had an excellent time. That's how warm this place is. Is that even at the coldest time, it was a delight to be here.
I fell down a lot, so I wasn't super
Geoff
thrilled.
Geoff had a serious falling down on the slippery sidewalks problem.
Yeah, four or five times in the first 2 days. Thank you.
Somebody bought him those things you put on the bottom of your shoes that are like cleats so you don't fall down. What are they called?
Yak tracks. That's what they're called. And then, so for the whole last day, I didn't fall down at all, but the damage was done.
Thank God it wasn't a six-day festival like this one.
You
could have really hurt yourself.
Yeah. How come there's no comedy panel at the comedy festival?
That's where they have the serious documentary panel. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Sorry to jump on you, Eric. Geoff and Eric participated the other night. Did anybody see the interruption of Top Gun over at the Old Town Playhouse? That movie was crazy to watch again. And there's a lot of scenes with the gentlemen in their underwear or towels or shirtless. And Eric got up to go to the bathroom at one point and basically stole the whole show by returning from the bathroom in just his underwear.
Did you have a volleyball with you?
Yeah, if things slow down today.
He's doing it already.
No, do you have good underwear on again today? Because you had underwear on that wasn't too bad. Like, it looked fresh there. Oh! That's so he could safely cross the street tonight, late at night. Hey. When he's going back to the hotel drunk.
It's the only way I can get a laugh.
You were playing with the boys.
What? Is that movie?
That's a song in the movie.
From Top Gun? Oh.
Playing with the boys. Yeah, that's playing during the exciting volleyball sequence.
Yeah, I think it's Kenny Loggins, yeah. The great Kenny Loggins.
Yeah, he has films. He has songs. Not only does he have like three songs on the soundtrack, but you know the themes from those songs play repeatedly. And it was interesting. And tonight, Geoff will be joining me to. We asked Eric to participate again, but now that I've seen that underwear, I rescind the invitation. But Geoff and I are going to be interrupting Speed at midnight, so I'm sure none of you will be there. But we have to be.
She's going to be there.
Yeah? Oh, it's your job, right? You got to take pictures. Oh, you bought tickets? Oh, fantastic.
Wow. Okay, so it'll be the three of us watching Speed. And the two of us talking during it.
So Geoff is a stand-up comic, in case you hadn't figured that out yet, who hasn't necessarily gotten into filmmaking yet, but he sure loves watching them.
I watch a lot of movies.
And was part of the reason why I was convinced to go off campus last night to see Mission Impossible, because I caught his excitement about it.
And, so much excitement.
How'd you feel about it?
I was disappointed.
You were disappointed as well.
I like everything, and I didn't like that movie. They really screwed it up.
Let's just go back down the line, back through the through everybody on the panel, and we'll stop. We'll end with Bob there on the other end, so he has time to think of maybe a two-word answer. Geoff, what's a comedy film that you are a fan of? Like, what's a comedy film that, you know, inspires you and was part of your upbringing and reason to get into comedy?
Fletch.
That's right.
I'm a big fan of Fletch.
We saw Kill the Messenger the other day, and a great movie. And Geoff was like, why didn't he just write the article under a pseudonym like Fletch does? And I was like, because Fletch wasn't real.
But my argument was that Fletch came out before he wrote that story. So the idea of using a different name had already existed. So why not? I mean, Mark Twain's real. That's not his real name. His real name is Hal Holbrook. But he goes by Mark Twain now.
All right, let's move on to Eric before Geoff convinces me that the guy in Kill the Messenger should have been a journalist under a fake name because of Fletch.
This is like the brainwashing movie where as soon as your opponent makes a good point, you're like, thank you, and commercial.
Do you have a comedy film that you are a big fan of, Eric?
I think Airplane comes to mind as one of the earliest that I saw in a theater, and
that movie is so great. Like, still holds up. Like, it's still fast-paced, hilarious jokes, and that style's been repeated so many times. Like, five scary movies, etc.
And like five Airplane sequels, even.
Yeah. There was a second one, yes. And don't you cross me on movies, Yeah, that movie's a great example. But you haven't done anything like that, though, right?
Like
that kind of movie.
No.
Like, obviously, Roseanne for President isn't a
documentary.
A quick series of gags. But I was reminded of Airplane when we were watching. What did we see the other day? Oh, the Best of Enemies, the Gore Vidal and William F. Buckley Jr. movie. That's practically a comedy. The things they say in that movie are so funny. And they showed the two of them debating and said that them debating on television sort of led to the idea of lots of pundits and constant debate on television and TV shows like Crossfire and stuff. And then they cut to a clip from SNL where Jane Curtin and Dan Aykroyd are arguing. And it still got a huge laugh when he said, "Jane, you ignorant." Like, that is still crazy hilarious, even though now it's probably even more inappropriate to say that to a woman.
Ever seen a grown man naked?
That of course is from Airplane. But then I went the long way to get here. But one of my favorite gags in Airplane is when they cut to a team that are debating against each other, a man and woman, about the plane that's in jeopardy up in the air. And the man says, "They bought their tickets. They knew what they were getting into. I say, let them crash."
That's how I feel about the audience here today.
Yeah, you know what you were doing when you came here. Adam, what about you? Do you have a favorite comedy film?
Yeah, I mean, if I go back, it's probably the film I watched over and over again when I was a kid was The Naked Gun.
Naked Gun.
Yeah, the first one. Yeah,
you're just cribbing off of Eric's answer.
Yeah, it's the same filmmakers, but it you know, maybe you're a little older than me. I don't know.
Hey.
So.
And it was fun. It was kind of fun to laugh at O.J. Simpson getting repeatedly beaten up and falling down at that time, and now it's even funnier.
Yeah. Yes. Yes. Now, I haven't seen it since I was probably 13 or 14, so I don't know if it still holds up. But at the time, it really influenced me, and it it's a toss between that or The Passion of the Christ. Those are.
Leslie Nielsen looking up a woman on a ladder and saying, "Nice beaver," and her handing him a beaver, it will always be one of the greatest film gags ever.
And when they practice safe sex, that's very important. That's how I learned how to practice safe sex. You remember they were
the full body condoms on. That's true.
The public schools are not great about teaching sex. You have to learn it from Naked Gun.
Bowman, do you have a favorite?
I got to say that I was probably 14 when I finally understood the full body condom joke. It's public schools suck. You're absolutely right.
I just got it just now. I didn't even, like, it was.
I just didn't get, like, why they wrap themselves in rubber and they're just squirming all over each other.
Yeah, why are they dressed up as ghosts?
That doesn't look comfortable. You know, it's not really a comedy film, but I never stopped laughing whenever West Side Story came on. My mother's Puerto Rican, and so to watch a bunch of people in brownface and, like, dancing as they're... I also grew up in New York City, so the idea that, you know, two gangs basically have to do 6 years of ballet before they can finally... Like, I just thought every single time I saw it, that and all the songs sound like things that drunk people would sing in my neighborhood, you know? Maria, you know?
Just yelling that at random windows from the alley.
Yeah, so I guess that's probably the most impactful comedic moment in my childhood, but I guess if it was one movie or another, it would, for comedy, I probably Ace Ventura, which probably just makes me be one of the youngest people in this room. But when he talks out of his ass, like, that's some primo comedy right there. You know, you can't do that in real life.
I can't.
No.
My dad's been talking out of his ass for 50 years. It's rarely funny.
Bob won.
Bob won. Oh, that'd be me. Well, I know this is going to date me, but I think Thomas Edison's The Sneeze from 1896. I mean, that knocks me out every time.
How much was the ticket to see that?
It's just so great. The guy sneezes, and then he sneezes again, and then to top it, he sneezes. So, okay. But
probably the first orgasm captured on film.
It's
The two actually that I think are very different. The Monty Python films, or Monty Python in general, for me was like just this crazy, absurdist, funny that never went on too long and would always, you know. So I guess The Life of Brian and the Holy Grail, especially the night scene, the black night scene, is great. The other ones would be Doctor Strangelove, because that movie is so dark and so crazy and meaningful, even now funny, and it comes out the same year as Failsafe. They're actually the same movie. I mean, they're the same movie in what they deal with, which is a nuclear war, the end of the world and everything. And you could actually play the clips of Henry Fonda, you know, talking as the president, and Peter Sellers. So you can actually match them up. So I think that's an amazing movie, and it's not really the type of movie that we really have anymore, which has no sweetness about it, no sugar to get you over like the dark part.
What do you think of The Brink, which is basically just trying to copy Dr. Strangelove?
I didn't see it, so I don't think anything of it.
There you go.
It's a new TV series
but,
on
but otherwise,
HBO.
I think it's great.
It's on HBO, The Brink, okay, and it's similar in tone, but I'd say more, certainly more, has more like it's sex stuff in it and drug stuff, and you know, it's.
There was sex and drug stuff in Doctor Strangelove.
Was there?
Yeah, in the general is with the.
Well, yeah, right, yeah. But if you watch Doctor Strangelove and you watch a lot of it, it just looks like a regular film. In other words, there aren't comedy cues. So if it's in the war room, the only slight comedy clue is that the facial expression, or a guy is chewing gum, rather. So there's, or when they're in the B-52, maybe he's chewing gum. But everything else that Stanley Kubrick did, when you look at that B-52, is absolutely realistic. So that's why, I mean, just a really interesting film for me.
Yeah, and played very straight, very serious actors, you know, other than, you know, and Peter Sellers, of course, we later learned could also be a great dramatic actor.
Yeah,
but,
yeah.
But, it, yeah, the whole thing is just very,
other than
very
Slim
dry.
Pickin, other than Slim Pickin.
Yeah!
It's great.
Who anyway, also is my favorite part of what a lot of people think is an awful movie, 1941. Slim Pickens is so funny in that. He kind of saves the movie. All right, let's go to Douglas.
I mean, now after the Doctor Strange, I feel like I should say like the Marx Brothers and, you know, like Duck Soup.
You want to
sound really
smart?
Sophisticated, but
yeah.
That's not the case. I think for me, I mean, it's probably why I made this movie. The only movie I've ever seen twice with my dad is Animal House. We went to like the 7 o'clock show. I don't know if anyone was in a fraternity, but I guess like the fraternities were sending out letters to not go to Animal House. It was going to ruin everyone's opinion. Of course, it saved fraternities, but we went to the 7 o'clock show in this small town, very much like Traverse City, Westport, Connecticut. Except no one went to Michigan State there, and we or Michigan, and so and we got right back in line for the 9:30, the opening night, and it's probably why in great part I made this movie. I love the humor in Animal House. I love that there's stuff that's like food fight that everyone remembers, but then there's things like you guys playing cards, just these off lines. I love the way they make fun of like the rich. Sort of, I hope it's okay in this, but like the sort of sophisticated, open-minded liberal kids who think that like they're really in with, you know, black people, and they're like, black people are like, what the, huh? You know, so I just love that. But the other reality is of anybody that likes National Lampoon that's probably was of my age, it's because there's a lot of in the movie and in the magazine. And that's really, so it's not, it's, I guess it's kind of some of the jokes and a lot of the.
Animal House actually was the first movie that I ever saw in a movie theater. This is a true story, because my mom thought it was about animals who lived in a house. True story.
Did she drop you off?
She went in with us. I distinctly remember being in a payphone booth, I date myself again, and she called my dad and she said, "What should I do?" And he said, "Let them watch the movie." So that's what happened.
I don't think there's anything particularly harmful in Animal House for kids. I certainly saw it when I was pretty young. It was one of my first R-rated movies. And not unlike National Lampoon, the magazine, I learned some things, you know, from the film. And it's just, it really holds up. Like, it's really, like, Every comedic beat, like you were saying, like just little throwaway lines, everything is so funny. It's so, to me, it's one of the most perfect comedies.
And they'll make fun of anything. I mean, that's what, you know, there's like in the parade at the end, there's this great tissue paper float of a black hand and a white hand shaking. It says togetherness. And then the car comes and rams right through it, just subtly pulls apart to sort of say, like, which is current to today as well. Like, it just still... just go after anything. And then there's some other, I think I haven't heard ethnic humor in that movie or since then, other than like a John Hughes movie sort of accidentally or on purpose has a lot of ethnic humor. If you watch 16 Candles, actually, other than this panel, 16 Candles is probably the thing that makes most fun of Chinese people that I've ever been involved with.
Yeah, whenever Long Duck Dong shows up, they hit a gong.
Yeah, exactly.
It's embarrassing. But also, National Lampoon, the one thing that Universal or somebody drew the line on was, I don't know what the gag was, but they had a JFK gag in the movie that didn't make the final cut, or maybe it wasn't even filmed.
Well, there's the magazine, there's a cover, well, depending, the magazine's pretty overridingly liberal in terms of the people that work there, but they hate the Kennedys. There's like every issue has a Chappaquiddick joke, if anybody remembers that. Or there's like a great ad of a Volkswagen. I don't know if anybody remembers the Volkswagen, like, could float. And the ad said, if Teddy Kennedy drove a Volkswagen, he'd be president. And you just don't get things like that much anymore. I was trying to
you
think
just
of
don't
the.
Don't get the, enough of that.
You know, Bob said he had submitted, had been in the Lampoon. I was trying to think of the. There's a number of people who are in both movies, and certainly that worked for both. There's a big tradition of it, and you know, I asked a lot of the right, you know, the artists, why, you know, how do you feel about the Lampoon now that it's gone? And one of the guys, Sam Gross, whose art you would immediately recognize as a New Yorker artist, much more probably than a Lampoon artist. And he would say he still gets these ideas, but there's no place to submit it. And so I was thinking, like, what's the difference? And it's sort of like he has this great cartoon where it's it must have been when the hand dryers came out. You know, those electronic hand dryers that don't really dry your hands, that are annoying. And so there's this great cartoon, and we're looking at it as we're looking for things in the movie. And it's got one guy with his hands under there trying to do it, and then the other guy's got his right in the blower, and he's like, yeah, and he said, like, I just don't have a place to submit that nowadays.
No, he doesn't. Actually, Sam is in both movies, and Sam, although he's been a New Yorker cartoonist for a long time, but with Lampoon, so he always does outrageous stuff, and that we can't print, and we can do a Q&A after my movie to tell you why or whatever, but so. When the first Danish cartoon controversy, the Muhammad cartoons, came out, and everybody ran scared about that. The New York Times wouldn't show them. No one would even show the cartoons. And the cartoons were so mild. I mean, if you actually looked at the cartoons. But Sam did a cartoon in which it had the bomber in heaven, and he's all in little pieces. And Muhammad is saying to him, you get the virgins when we find your penis. which we didn't run, but I think made a pretty good point.
Did you think about changing it to like that? That gives it a little more punch. You can get the virgins when we find your dick. Would that have helped?
I was just going to say, I'm glad. I'm glad we waited till after 10 a.m. to throw the word out there. That was nice of you to hold back. Bob, number two, are you ready?
I felt it was too early for me to hear the word actually. I also wondered if Jen was having sex right now rather than being at the panel. Does anyone else wonder if she's having sex?
That's okay, but made you weird?
Yeah, I mean, it was in my head. I don't want to answer your question.
Perfect.
A no-word answer. No, I like Borat a lot. It's a movie that actually premiered here, and it's a big movie for me.
It's the first movie I really noticed a penis on screen. It's an intimate moment that he has when they're rolling over each other and everything, and his balls are in his face. It's really the first time in my life that I realized, you know, what you could do with cinema.
Well, Larry Charles on this panel a few years ago actually said that the guy, not the Sacha Baron Cohen, but the other guy, didn't understand why they were doing the scene and kept telling Larry Charles, like, I don't understand the scene. Why do you want me to be naked in the scene? And Larry just said, well, let's just do it that way. It's going to work.
Just shut up.
Just shut up and take off your clothes, Ken. That particular scene is probably one of the few times in my life that I've laughed out loud at male nudity in a film. Usually it makes me uncomfortable, like in Top Gun. But, and on this stage, Eric. Borat was just, we all love Larry Charles, but that movie is just like, it's just so special and not like anything else. And to this day, when I hear the words "my wife," I immediately go, "My wife."
Everyone does. Yeah, everyone does.
And it gets me into some awkward situations sometimes. All right. So now that we covered that, is there anybody? And this could be in any order. Before we go to opening up to the audience. Oh, and for me, one of my favorite comedies of all time. Mel Brooks's Young Frankenstein really holds up and tells a story that moves me at the end of it every time I see it, even though it's a hilarious comedy throughout, and that's hard to do. But I wanted to ask everybody if they've seen a comedy or otherwise, any film that they've seen at the festival that you weren't involved with that you would recommend, and tell everybody to check out if it plays again, or they could see it in whatever formats it shows up on in the future. Geoff, you want to start us off? What's a movie that you really liked here at the festival?
I thought you said any order.
Yeah,
I'm trying to remember frantically.
But since we have a panel of people that didn't seem anxious to jump in, I'm going to let you start it off.
I love the Monty Python documentary. The Meaning of Live. I like
Meaning
that
of Live. We watched that out on the Naughty Cat. We went out on the boat and saw that movie. So it was fun to be laughing and fighting off seasickness at the same time.
It gave it a real 4D experience. They should show Titanic on that boat.
Miss, are you leaving because you were reminded you could be having sex right now? She's got to stand in a line. She's jonesing to stand in a line. Like, some people come for the movies, but some people come for standing in line.
You can have sex in line.
And you can have sex in line if you want to.
You can also stand in line for sex.
Have you guys seen all three versions of the scene where you think the young guy is coming out to his parents and it turns out that he's just got... There's three versions. You got to see all three.
There's still one I haven't seen. And yeah. I don't have any idea.
I'll tell you about it if you don't catch it by the end of it. I think it's my favorite of the three, the one you haven't seen. Have you seen anything, Eric, or have you just been drunk and in your underwear the whole time?
I've pretty much been drunk in my underwear the whole time, but I did be sure to make time and check out a movie. I really liked Top Gun. It was the first time I saw it. Had its emotional moments.
Did it take your breath away?
It took my breath away.
Yeah, that movie. I'm still having trouble getting over it. Like that. Like at the end, when they go to fight the enemy, they don't say anything about who the enemy is. It's just bad guys that have a fighter jet that the U.S. doesn't have for some reason.
The MiG.
Yeah, the MiG. They keep talking about it like, we wish we had that cool of a jet. It's like, why wouldn't
we? So we'll just shoot it down instead.
Yeah. We'll shoot it down with our lesser jets, but we have great pilots.
They also have just black masks. You don't see any faces.
Yeah. It's very scary.
They're like TIE fighter pilots.
They did. There was a point where the planes are flying away. They look like TIE fighters. What's that?
Is it the Russians?
No, it's never specified. Do they never ever say
who it is? I don't remember them
ever
saying who it was.
It's kind of unclear. Or we were talking over it when they said it. But they just sort of were just told, we got to go. And then, like, they have to go the next day. And this is, like, the day after Tom Cruise's character quits because he's so upset about his wingman's death. He's mentally unstable. And they're like, he's got to be in one of the first planes out there.
It's probably the first movie about PTSD, huh?
I think so,
and
yeah.
Just get over it.
Yeah. Immediate PTSD.
Just go kill some people. You'll feel better.
I mean, that's not terrible advice.
I saw the movie Good Kill. It's not a comedy at all. I think there's no laughs in it, but I saw Good Kill the other day, and that's about a guy who's a drone pilot, but he's upset not about killing innocent women and children. He's upset about the fact that he can't do it in an actual plane anymore. Like, he wants to go back and kill people with a plane instead of sitting in a trailer in Las Vegas. So I think that movie, Good Kill's a good title for it, but I think a better title would have been Butthurt Locker.
That is a movie.
That's already a
movie. No, that exists.
That's in the back section at the video store.
I think it
store.
Premiered here back in 2006.
Do you have a movie that you enjoyed seeing here at the festival?
Yeah, I've mostly seen documentaries.
They should warn us before we go in.
Yeah, I should.
Because I saw one day comedy. I saw four documentaries. Yeah. It's all docs.
Last night I saw, it was funny, Do I Sound Gay? I thought there were some...
No, you sound like a straight person.
So, yeah, that had some, you know, some humorous interviews in it.
And, uh-huh. They mostly talk to dudes that sound gay?
Yeah, mostly. There's a couple people that didn't sound so gay.
He doesn't want to say anything now. He's just trying to get away from that.
What about you, Bowman?
I guess I think that I'd recommend probably Deep Web, which is another documentary. I think if you really want to understand, this is too, it's a really sober point to make, but it's basically about what's wrong with everything involved in internet regulation. And there's nothing funny there, I guess. I guess you could make a porn joke now.
I'm
trying, but there's deep, deep web. Well, right.
I thought that movie was about ducks having sex.
There it is.
It's not a funny film, but it was directed by Alex Winter, one of the stars of Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure.
And narrated by Keanu Reeves.
That's right.
Oh, well, now I'm definitely going to see it.
Yeah.
That's
a
fun tie. Is this like the third one? Like, do they spin this as the trilogy, the Bill and Ted trilogy?
Before we get to Bob number one, I have a sidebar question for Bowman, just out of my own curiosity. What is your favorite Matthew Modine film?
I want to say Top Gun, because he was supposed to be in it.
He was?
Yeah, but he turned it down after he I think, got to that bathroom scene. Tom Cruise is leaning over
It's a weird scene, and it's described
like half the
script.
Yeah, no, they describe it intricately.
Which one of the guys was he supposed to be?
Tom Cruise.
For reals?
Yep. For reals, yeah. It's on Wikipedia.
He was offered it first. But he disagreed with the Reagan-era politics.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, it's...
He went on to do Full Metal Jacket.
They should have called that movie Jingo All the Way.
Probably Memphis Belle. And that's because I remember being on the set. It's like one of my first memories is... they let me go up in the B-17, which you could never get away with now, but like it was an actual, you know, World War II era plane. And I actually fell asleep out the window because the drone of the engines is like the most soothing sound in the world. So yeah, probably that one. That, and I knew everybody, like, you know, Sean, like everybody's in that movie. So I just felt like I was, every time I saw it, I was like, oh, my childhood.
The old gang, yeah.
Yeah, we're all together in the plane.
I loved, I'm a huge fan of Married to the Mob. I love that movie and him in it. All right, let's go to Bob, Bob number one. Have you seen anything that you can recommend?
I just got here, but I'm really excited about seeing the new Tom Cruise film.
It's playing at the mall on the other side of town.
I am excited about seeing the National Lampoon because Sam Gross, who's in both of them, the movie, very semi-serious, I think is really good. And David Remnick was in the office, and the editor of The New Yorker, and Sam was there also. And David and Sam seen both films, and David said, so well, what do you think of Very Semi-Serious? He said, it's okay, but you should really see the National Lampoon film. So on that recommendation, I am.
Fair enough. Douglas?
Let's see. I want to say, I want to recommend Birdie for Matthew Modine film. I love the movie Birdie.
Right.
Which is a great film.
Nicolas Cage before he cracked.
Yeah. The
before his teeth got fixed.
The film, I saw a documentary called City of Gold. I don't know if anybody saw that.
Yeah, I saw that. It's terrific.
And I thought that was, I really liked that a lot. It wasn't.
What's that about?
It's about Jonathan Gold, a food writer in L.A., but it really ends up being like a motif of these different sort of ethnic areas of Los Angeles, and it's good. It's pretty good for any documentary. When I show our documentary, you know, because a lot of times it's not at a place where they have a comedy panel, you know, and you're playing between like a Holocaust film and a like Save the World from AIDS film, and I have to get up there and say, I just want, it's a spoiler alert, but like the staff of the Lampoon does not like go to Africa and save kids in this movie. And so because people think a documentary, other than if Michael Moore's in it, is, you know, has to have this serious message. So that, the fact that like City of Gold is sort of a little bit uplifting in a way I liked. I did. I couldn't sleep last night. I did see a movie, sort of soft. What do they call that? Softcore.
Softcore.
I don't
know.
It might have just been homemade, but it was on in the hotel. It was called The Women of the Upper Peninsula, and I really, that was awesome. And I'm hoping that
one of the stars of that film just left.
I don't want to like cause a stir. There are a couple. Well, just leave it at that. Can I get your autograph? No, I'm just kidding.
Bob, where do you stand on this question? Are you in for it or you want to pass?
Well, you know, I saw that Winehouse doc. That's a laugh riot for sure.
Super fun movie.
Wall to wall comedy. You know, I saw it here, and the audience actually, before the Winehouse docs, did a sing-along to the Rehab song. Which is the most deeply macabre thing I've ever witnessed.
They really did that?
Yeah, it was real Stepford Wives type stuff here in Traverse City.
The audience was singing it?
Yeah. Who was here? Anybody here? Yeah, we had a little sing-along to the Rehab
They always have musical artists before the movies. Did that person sing the song and everybody sang along? That's what happened? There wasn't like words
that
on the screen and a bouncing ball?
Yeah, I'll never forget it.
Yeah, our dad wasn't so great with that advice to not go to rehab. It didn't work out so good. So let's open the floor to the questions that people have. We've got... some folks are going to come out here with some microphones and run over to anybody that's waving at them that they have something they want to ask. I don't have to pick people. They'll just run over to people that are next, like this one right here.
Bob One, New Yorker?
Yes.
I'm a subscriber, and I have tried to tell, describe one of your cartoons, and I'd like you to try to describe, and so that in a way that, will you describe it for us in a way that will make us laugh.
Okay.
The one about the two rams about to butt heads.
That's incredible that he.
If you had to guess, how many cartoons have you?
Well, let's see. There are 80,000 cartoons.
Well, I could start if you want me to.
Well, okay.
I feel like you just did.
This is.
There are two what? Lambs?
No,
rams.
Rams. They're about to butt heads. They're butting heads.
Ram. Yeah, I forgot the exact caption. It's about celibacy or.
No. Now just set the stage and get us to laugh, because I've tried to. I've been fairly successful in repeating that cartoon to friends, but let's see if you can.
Okay.
What?
Yeah, how about this? Okay. Here's. there's a doctor. And there's a patient, and he's saying to the patient, "You'll be awake during the entire procedure. The anesthesiologist is on vacation." All right, that makes people laugh. Does that work? Okay, let's move on.
That's one where you don't have to see the visual to enjoy.
Except there are rams rather than a doctor. It's the same cartoon, but with rams.
That was when you were in your Gary Larson phase. Animals. But I'm dying to know what this ram thing is all about. Can we get the microphone back to this guy?
What did the ram say?
Wait, where
is it? I can't remember the caption.
Because he says he can get a laugh with it. Let's see if he's lying.
I'll see if I can get a laugh.
Yeah.
Okay, so these two rams are sitting there, and they're about to butt heads.
Sitting where?
Well...
They're up where rams are.
Yeah. Is it a mountain?
Up where rams are, where they hang out. So the ones...
Like
the
ram ones, bar?
You and I lounge?
These are animals, not...
These... Okay, they're about to butt heads, and the one is thinking, do I... I'm weighing whether I should risk brain damage...
All right.
Or... lead a life of celibacy.
Yeah. Okay. The problem is we need to act it out. Yeah.
Wait, are these?
The problem is whether I should risk brain damage. It's a football joke, a concussion joke.
Wait, are they saying?
Or lead a life of celibacy. Let's hear it.
There we go.
I feel like you stole that cartoon from the women of the Upper Peninsula.
I appreciate that.
No, I've read your magazine. Yeah. The Rams of the Upper Peninsula.
This one's for Doug.
I
was first exposed to your style of comedy.
Hey, exposed is the wrong. Don't ever say that again about anybody ever.
Noted.
We have cameras on these people, right?
I mean, a guy up here made a movie called Registered Sex Offender, and then you say, I was first exposed to you. There's a different way to say that.
Yeah,
have some class.
You were first exposed to Wine Rib today, and his yellow. Go ahead.
Electric lime green, but whatever. So.
Lime green, but whatever.
Anyway,
that's the
details. That's the caption on my favorite New Yorker cartoon.
I first saw you at midnight on Comedy Central.
You were exposed to me within the last year and a half.
Yes, unfortunately.
No, it's not unfortunate. I was just letting everybody know how young you are. What?
My question is, while Chris Hardwick on the show, he seems like a nice guy. Is he a in person? is he a bad person? Like in real life?
This is amazing.
Are you just suspicious of anyone who's nice on television? Oh, that guy must be a douche in person.
It's a healthy I think. I mean,
ruining careers left
and
right.
Off the record.
He's a longtime friend. When he started out in the business, I had been in it for a while, and then he catapulted past me after a lot of hard work, and now I'm on his show, and I love doing it, and he's a nice fella. He's very busy, so that sometimes can be misconstrued as, hang on, I'm getting a call.
Thanks.
But thanks for watching. Yeah, at midnight on Comedy Central, I'm going to be on again on Wednesday, August 13th or 12th, whatever that Wednesday is. Next up.
How many of you guys are in therapy and who wants to talk about it?
I am.
It's really a serious problem.
So. Yeah, I see a therapist once a week.
I should, but I don't.
That's, I did that for a long time, too. Do you really want to talk about it?
I Skype with mine.
Are you going to do call-ins? Mine won't do call-ins.
No, I actually appreciate it more. I feel more open if I'm just staring. I mean, like, if I'm in my underwear at home just talking to my therapist, I feel like I'm...
No, she won't. She says she got to see body language and stuff to know what I'm actually thinking or whatever. And I'm like, that's a little scary, but.
Mine's only $15 a session, though, so.
Mine's 20, sliding scale, because we're broke.
Exactly.
Yeah, but, yeah.
Sure, I mean, it's not a 900 number? No.
Wait, are you in your underwear or is she in her underwear?
I imagine we both are.
You just call phone sex operators and then they're like, what do you want me to do? And you're like, I just want a hug. Do you know why my mom never really cared about me?
I dated a phone sex operator and she said like half the calls are that.
Really?
Yeah, no, for real. That's not a joke.
No, I know. I'm sure she told you that, but I'm sure it was also like, you know, most of them just want to chat. Like she was trying to put you at ease. What do you just talk dudes off all day? Listen, a lot of them just like to chat. Like it's not.
I'm providing.
It's not exactly
service.
What you think. Like some of them are just like, what are you doing? Do you like chicken mole? And you're like, it's not that weird, Ma. Like you're telling your parents. A lot of them just want to chat. It's no big deal.
The kid that asked me the Chris Hardwick question and his, I assume, mother just left.
Can we get them back in here?
Like I think the mom was like, you got in your stupid question. Let's go. You finally got to find out the truth.
It's the last piece of the puzzle for his is Chris Hardwick a thesis paper.
Here we go. But thank you for the therapy question. That really led to some awesome comedy.
My question is for Bob, whoever wants to answer. What is your favorite movie with or featuring Chinese people?
That's a great question. It's funny. The comedy panel seems to lead to people wanting to be funny, asking the questions, which I know Doug does not like that. I can tell.
I just am sitting here trying to think of a movie I liked that has Chinese people in it.
Yeah. Transformers Extinction.
Okay.
No.
I was going to say Rush Hour, but is that wrong?
Like, he's from
Hong Kong and China?
No, it's different.
What about Breakfast at Tiffany's? Mickey Rooney?
Yeah. Oh.
That is the worst.
Too soon.
I don't know why anybody thought that performance that he gave in that movie was funny at any point in history. Like, it is so over the top and weird in an otherwise elegant and smart movie. It's bizarre. But I can't. Do you have any?
I'm going to answer your question one on one afterwards. We do have a Japanese parole officer in Registered Sex Offender, actually.
There you go.
And that's qualifying as Japanese. But
he's Japanese, though.
She is. And she's actually based on the half Korean cop from The Wire. Do you remember that woman, the half Korean cop from mm-hmm. The Wire? And I said she's based on the half Korean cop, and I told the actor that, and she said, why don't you get her to play it? I remember that she shouldn't tell actors that they're based on other actors.
Why do you have to lean back at all? Why do you have to do that?
The kind of anarchy.
You're on stage. On the back of a classroom. He almost fell over because he's leaning back in his chair. Okay, we got one over here.
So speaking of phone sex, where are the women?
That's what I was going to say earlier.
That is a great question.
They're
with all the Chinese people.
I got sidetracked earlier, but I was going to say that was what happened last year on this panel is towards the very end, I think it was even. A woman not only asked that question when there were, in fact, two women on the stage, She was very, very mad about the lack of women in comedy, and somehow that fell upon all of us on stage to, you know, to just like start. Like it's like I know I never am in a position to hire anyone to do anything, so I can't. But I would definitely hire women.
Wait, the rest of you were hired to be here?
No.
I got an
the
email.
The question was more like, why aren't there more women in comedy? But she was angry about it. Are you still mad about it? She's still
come
mad.
Come on up here. Come on up here.
No.
Come on.
No, 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 no,
no,
no.
That's
no.
The last thing we're going to do. Let's get her a microphone.
This is the best panel I've ever been on. This is...
No, no, that's,
no,
that's
no.
Cool.
Yeah. No.
Thank you. The reason I was upset...
The professional comedians know you don't ever just let somebody come up on stage and give them a microphone.
Oh, the people who make documentaries where you just shoot for 2 years and cut it down to 90 minutes are like, yeah, whatever the f*** happens, that's fine.
You got like 5 minutes.
We'll get 10 seconds out of it.
You asked the question about what comedians have influenced you in your career and who has been distinguished for you.
The moderator last year asked
that question. Yeah. And not one of the comics or the men on the stage mentioned one single woman. There was no reference to Roseanne Barr or Carol Burnett.
Well, that's
or
not,
Robin
you're not
Tyler,
being fair. You're not being fair to us or our experiences growing up doing that because everybody looks for relatable material and I don't relate to us. Roseanne. I relate to other comedians who talk like men, like because I'm a man. I don't know if you can, like, that's the difference. If
right, I can understand.
I didn't say I watched Drew Carey because women aren't funny. I said I watched Drew Carey because he was a dumb, fat idiot, and so was I.
All right. I can understand that. I can excuse you. But
I don't
I
need
nevertheless.
I don't need excused from that.
You can
why would I need to be excused
that.
For that?
Just,
yeah.
Yes.
And there were two. There were two women on the stage last year, and I don't recall what their responses were. But you were just—it's more out of you're not angry about it. You're just more curious why.
I was upset. I was when.
Oh, she is angry.
You almost got out.
I'm still upset about it.
No, let me ask you a question. Let me ask you a question.
There are so many wonderful women comics in American history, and not one single woman was named as an influence.
But are you asking people to lie then, just to fill in the blank?
Are you asking? Do you want me to have your experience? Do you want me to have your experience all the way up until I'm on this stage and you ask that question?
Yes, we have your experience all the time.
Yeah, I know, because I'm a comedian, and you come see me explain it.
I made a movie about Roseanne Burr,
yes.
And I mentioned her, but
I'd love to see that.
I'm still with you. I'm upset there's no women up here.
Mm, me too.
I understand.
Yeah.
Wait, but that wasn't what it was about last year, and I pointed
it
out this year because it's funny to me that a year has gone by, and this lady's...
From Sydney, Australia.
Her impact on last year was the opposite of good, because... There are less women on the panel this year than there were last year.
This is true. It's got worse, not better.
No, it's not getting worse, though. There. I believe we went on to list about a dozen women in comedy, and I could do so again right now. I love lots of women that are in comedy, but the initial question was, who are your influences? And unfortunately, as a child, I was more influenced by Bill Cosby, and now I'm sad to say that.
Trainwreck is a massive hit.
Yeah, yeah.
And a hilarious movie.
And Amy Schumer is a.
Have you seen Trainwreck yet, ma'am?
No, you haven't?
So you don't? So you're mad that there's not enough women and then you don't support the ones there are?
They don't. They don't have cinemas in where she's from. That's why she has to come all the way to Traverse City to see a movie and...
Your question is you're upset about the
Wait,
people
really
who book all this stuff.
No, that was the out. Nice that was the out. Other
before you got on last year's, the real question was why aren't there any women up here on the panel? You went off on the weird old story. The first woman was asking you why isn't, and this wouldn't be up to you who was up on the panel. But why aren't there any women sitting in chairs up there?
We'll have to ask Deb Blake, the female director of this festival.
That's the problem with filmmaking in general, And it's also true of people of color and women and the LGBT community. They, all of them need to have higher positions in the film industry, have to be the people that are making the decisions, so there'll be more films and made by and for and with women. But like Geoff just mentioned, the success of Trainwreck is a big deal because it's a movie about a young woman written by a young woman that is, you know, successful right now as we speak.
And they're currently filming an all-female Ghostbusters.
Ghostbusters, yeah. So
which is going to be such a
hit. I don't know if
hit.
That's a move in the right direction to remake something that was perfect the way it was.
But there was no women Ghostbusters, and that's going to upset a lot of people.
Yeah.
But now there's a bunch of women.
I hope that their secretary is a man with glasses.
I can't wait for the moment where they remake the scene. You know, like when the ghost.
Well,
comes
they'll call
in
it. It'll be a different act this time. Wait, do you think the lady Ghostbuster is going to a ghost in the remake scene?
Way to keep it classy. All right, let's go.
Could I say something here? Because the question of diversity comes up in the...
Yeah, why no female rams in your cartoons?
Well, because they don't have horns.
Actually, there are plenty. Of course, Roz Trast is probably the preeminent cartoonist at The New Yorker. The film will show Liana Fink and Emily Flake, who are breaking into it. I think in general, you have to ask, why in general... historically, have there been so many more men in comedy? Is it due to prejudice keeping women out, or is it due to the really strong cultural factors about what it is to be funny and what you're allowed to do? A lot about being funny is just being bad, saying the wrong thing, speaking up, getting kicked out of class. The culture generally tells women to conform a lot more. They're rewarded for being good. Very good, and not saying the wrong thing, not doing all the things that you do here to be funny. So you have really strong cultural factors in terms of why aren't there more black cartoonists at The New Yorker? Well, there's not that many black cartoonists, okay? And that's a deep sociological problem in our country, that comedy somehow is getting blamed for, you know, who goes to school, the economy, and everything else. But where you see things moving actually is in the right direction on this. All-white, all-male comedy panel notwithstanding.
Half-white.
We're half also not...
I'm a 15th Cherokee.
I would just want to add that when we show our film, it seems like there's always somebody who is there just to ask why in 1972 didn't I hire any women to work at the National Lampoon, which, you know, as if I was running the thing. And, you know, you didn't put enough women in your movie. I'm like, they didn't work there. But there were three women on the staff there. When one and Beats went on to be an Emmy Award-winning writer at Saturday Night Live, first female writer there. And they'll sort of say, well, you don't have anyone in the movie pointing out that there's no women at the National Lampoon. And I'm like, well, then how did you just assess that there was only, you know, three women there? My question would be to people, how many women were working at like US News and World Report? You know, it's just, or you know, in Mad Men, why don't they have a character come out and say there's only one woman, you know, artist? So I think a lot of it is, you know, it's not the fault, I think, of the people who are trying to tell those stories, I guess is what I would say.
Why aren't there more white people in Roots? You know, like, seems to focus a little too much on these black people and their troubles, you know?
Right. I mean, Gilda Radner, who was part of the National Lampoon, you know, I mean, she was great. I mean, why are there not... haven't been more of those, but I do think it like is heading in the
it's absolutely
in the right
getting
direction.
Better. And like as a longtime stand-up comic, I can tell you that what Bob One was saying about culturally is the craziest thing to me is that my entire career, whenever I've worked with a woman, I've had women tell me that they don't want to see women doing stand-up comedy. I know you're not saying that.
But that's part of the answer, though.
That's you know, I'm saying that there's just something about, like Bob was saying, that like it just was a male-dominated thing, and that's what people wanted to see, and even women had that feeling. But that is certainly changing and will continue to change until women are in charge of everything, and we'll be in the audience going, how come there are no men up there?
That will never.
But there will be no more wars, so
I think there's a psychological thing to it also, where there's like a desperate need for attention. That a lot of like the girls I know, they like. I think that like comics are just trying to make their dads laugh, and a lot of girls grow up with their dad's attention, and a lot of the guys I know that grew up didn't get that, and the girls I know that grew up did.
That's weird.
What?
I just figured there were no women on the panel because they were so smart that they're on the 11 o'clock panel. They didn't have to get up. They didn't get woken up at 9 o'clock saying you're late.
Well, we didn't. We don't book this panel.
It's true. Okay, I think we're winding down. We're going to wrap it up.
Let's end on that note.
At 11
right?
o'clock.
Yeah.
No, let's get a question from a woman.
I don't know if I have a question. I think I have a statement.
Uh-oh.
What I...
Do
get
it.
Out the podium.
I have a
it's
question.
Not a statement.
All right, I have a question. But what I noticed among all of you is you all chose broad, except maybe the man from The New Yorker, broad physical humor is what made you laugh. I don't necessarily think that that's what makes women laugh the hardest. And I found you all hysterical.
Have you ever seen Young Frankenstein?
Yes.
That's pretty funny.
Yeah.
Roll in the hay.
But
you're
mean,
right
I,
about National Lampoon. That guy's crass.
When I think of comedies that made comedians that make me laugh really hard, other than Roseanne Barr, I mean, I think of the George Carlin's kind, you know, the ones that give me a
yeah, men out. Like George Carlin.
Well, men, women, I'm just saying women laugh at different things, I think, and are interested in a lot of different things.
I agree with you on the, like, women generally don't like slapstick. Like, women
right.
are,
the
not
broad
gonna, are not
the broad humor, the physical
fans.
Humor. And each of you chose that as your favorite.
What would your
we
answer
chose,
have been?
We chose pretty smart, clever comedies. We
yeah,
didn't really choose.
But they're broad.
I chose
we didn't
dance
say
movie.
We loved Three Stooges or whatever, but they're...
Yeah, Fletch isn't real slapstick.
We don't need to go through exactly what we all answered on that, but
Airplane.
If you want to tack a question on, that'd
Take
be awesome.
Done.
Well, I guess I don't.
Okay.
Wait, what was your movie? I want to know her movie. What would you have answered? What's
oh,
your
yeah,
movie?
What's your favorite comedy movie?
Well, I mean, I like Amy Schumer. I think she's very smart and she takes...
She's not a movie, though.
Did you see Trainwreck?
Which movie?
Well, Trainwreck is the one.
Yeah.
You
yeah.
know, and,
did you see it?
Yeah. Okay. And I like the one, I like the heavyset woman, I can't remember her name, that's in Mike.
Roseanne Burr?
Yeah.
Melissa
well,
McCarthy?
Well, I love Roseanne.
Melissa
Try not to ever be near a microphone again.
Got a question?
Okay.
I kind of want to audition a bit you. Where I say, I can't think of Melissa McCarthy's name and I call her the heavyset woman.
That's sexist.
I like the fat lady Ghostbuster. All right, one more. Let's end on a question.
All right, this is a question not about feminism or Chinese people. Where do you see comedy going, and like what trends do you see taking, and what do you think is going to take the course?
Whoa.
That's a good question. I thought that we'd heard Apatow's death rattle a few years ago, but we haven't. And I keep waiting for that to end. So that's my answer.
Wait, the progress of comedy is stopping something?
No, just something else is going to come out of the ashes of the Apatow kind of wheezing.
A phoenix, if you will.
He's a big... big force for me and a big influence for me, and I'm also done. I don't want to. I'm done with it.
You're making me nervous with that chair.
I don't get that at all. But anybody
Geoff,
else?
What about you?
Anybody else want to answer where's comedy going? Maybe somebody can make a documentary on that very subject.
I feel like I feel like the internet's going to have a big part in it.
The inner what?
Whatever happens, it's going to be on
going.
The internet.
That's going to the internet.
That guy,
probably
going to
be something
here.
On YouTube.
Yeah.
It's 11.
I will say that as far as the future of comedy goes, I have a series that's on YouTube because no network TV would, or even cable at this point would touch it, which is, it's called Getting Dug with High, and it's me and my guests just smoke weed the entire time and have a conversation and see where it goes. And oftentimes the guests on that show are ladies and Asian. And one time we had an Asian lady. Thank you to everybody on the panel. Thank you to everybody for getting up early and coming out. And hopefully by next year, there'll be more women in comedy and in film. Enjoy the rest of your fest. We'll be right back.